Looking at seismic work to determine the structure and ideally storage capacity of potential reservoirs for CO2.
We can pick up on things like vegetation communities that use groundwater.
We use airborne electromagnetic data, AEM data, to help us map near surface variations in electrical conductivity. And from that we can infer a number of things, including the nature of the geology, but also the nature of the groundwater, the presence of saline groundwater versus fresh groundwater.
We also deploy seismic in the search for potential hydrocarbon resources, both onshore and offshore.
The geoseismologist analyses earthquakes as they're coming, and they're required to alert on those earthquakes within 10 minutes. And we issue tsunami warnings based on that earthquake advice.
We also acquire MODIS and ABHRR data, which we process on a daily basis to extract hotspot information, which provides indication of potentially where there could be fires in the landscape.
We're collating flood studies and satellite information into one spot so that you can actually have a look at a place and see over time what's happened there in terms of flooding.
And this gives us a really good understanding about how things have changed in the past and gives us some really good foresight as to how things may change in the future.
Australia happens to be in a hot spot with these augmentations. When they become available, you'll be able to see sufficient satellites to get really good positioning, even in the middle of high-rise CBDs.
We hope to be able to deliver a product that will enable users to position their mobile phones to around 2 centimetres. So we're taking its scientific infrastructure and making it available to the general public.
The ability for people to access remote sensing product through their mobile phone has effectively transformed expectations from the public about the access to environmental information from remote sensing.
We track GNSS satellites, we track remote sensing satellites, bring data back from remote observatories, including observatories in the South Pacific and Antarctica. It then goes to the international community where it's used for a whole range of things.
We have a growing archive of over 30 years.
30 years ago, it was a difficult task to process one satellite image. Now we can process tens of thousands in a day, potentially.
And with the launch of Landsat 8 now, we've got a continuation of that.
I can look at one spot and I can say, find the water, and go all the way back through time. And I can do it for all of Australia in one go. So we've taken all of our imagery right through our entire archive, and we've made them available in a constant, accessible way.
In future, I think it'll be really exciting to integrate new satellite sensors and to use methods of data interoperability to look at the landscape in new ways.
Now that we're actually working in a supercomputing environment, we're enabled to include other agencies all around the world in collaborative environments. That means a lot more accessibility for data, a lot faster outputs, and a lot broader impact of what we do.
In the next 5 years or so, there are going to be some amazing satellites.
It used to be the domain of scientists and technical specialists only to make use of this information. But the combination of satellite remote sensing and high-performance computing is transforming our ability to make use of the information that we collect from satellites.